a recent poll found that only 4% of Americans trust insurance companies. And as Dennis Kucinich pointed out, that's within the margin of error. So it's possibly that nobody in this country trusts insurance companies at all. Why do you think that's true?
I'm not surprised. I know it's true because I've seen the polling over the years, and it hasn't changed a lot, although I think right now it's even the industry will acknowledge, well, they might not acknowledge it, but it's true. They're probably at the lowest point they've ever been. Because the insurance industry has forced so much change on Americans, and they realize that most Americans do, that even if they like or say they like the insurance plan that they have, they're very concerned about the future and what the insurance industry might do to them, and I think rightfully so.
So people say that about a third of the $2.4 trillion or so dollars in the healthcare system every year, roughly a third, goes to the insurance industries and the activities of the for-profit insuring system. So where does all that money go, and how much of it actually goes to people's healthcare?
Well, I think that's probably a pretty correct assumption. Last year alone, just for the seven largest health insurance companies in this country that are for-profit, they had $250 billion in revenue. A lot of that goes to pay overhead and to pay things or cover things like sales and marketing and underwriting, and also to pay very, very high executive salaries, and also to put a lot of money in the pockets of the investors that own the company. Companies.
And what about the actual, I mean, they're supposed to be in the business of providing healthcare. So what about the actual amount of the industry's revenue that goes to healthcare?
You know, it's changed a lot over the last 15 years. In 1993, 95 cents out of every dollar, every premium dollar, went to pay medical claims. Over the course of those years, it's gradually declined. And in 2006, it had reached to just slightly over 80%. So in other words, now 80 cents of every dollar goes to pay medical claims as compared to 95 cents just 15 years ago. So it's changed a lot, and a lot of that is because the industry has become for-profit. The industry's changed a lot in those years. There's been an enormous amount of consolidation to the point that there really is kind of a cartel of insurance companies in this country now.
Tell me about, give me a little broader picture of that, of these last 15 years. How has the landscape changed? And I think you can map it against changes in American society, too. You're talking about the time of the last stock market bubble, of the embrace of risk and speculation on Wall Street, which has had such catastrophic effects on the economy, the world economy.
That's very true. What has happened since the failure of the Clinton plan back in 1994, the private industry has just more or less been able to rule the healthcare system, and it has. Become, I guess, a dominant force in healthcare in this country is the insurance industry. What has happened is that, again, it has become more for-profit, and after the Clinton plan fell, also the insurance industry was able to start herding people against their will, frankly, into managed care plans, out of plans that they were pretty happy with at the time, and that's one reason why I think the insurance industry's reputation is so low, is because of the way they've been forced out of plans that they ran into plans that they don't like. It's happening again now. The industry has pretty much realized that it has done about all it can do with managed care. Some of the things it did were very onerous to doctors and to individuals who became patients, and so they rebelled against some of the most restrictive things that the insurance industry imposed on them. Now they're trying to move everyone again into what they refer to as consumer-directed plans, and they're anything but consumer-directed.
So I don't think we're going to be able to explain to our international audience the meaning of all of these terms.
That's a very good point. Yeah.
But do give me a sense of how, from a person's point of view, who has, let's say, a private insurance plan, what it means to be in managed care, what it means to be in consumer-directed care, and how the industry actually achieves that transition.
Yeah, I think that's a very good point, because the American system is quite unique. And people who are enrolled in private plans are pretty much at the mercy of whether or not an insurance company will approve a certain procedure that's being requested by a doctor. It may sound odd, but there actually is a corporate bureaucrat that really stands between a patient and his or her doctor, who can make actually life and death decisions, and have. And I've seen them, and I've been a part of what we used to call high profile cases in which it was exactly what was going on. The industry does control a great deal of the American healthcare system.
I want to talk about messaging a little bit later, but the notion that the insurance industry is making medical decisions about what people are allowed to have and what they're not allowed to have is a stark contrast to the fears that are being raised about the government playing that role in a possibly a new sort of healthcare system.
It really is, and it's a continuation of the same scare tactics and the fear mongering that the industry has engaged in for many, many years, going back to the early 90s, the last time we had a major debate on reform in this country. They raise the specter of a government bureaucrat between, you know, calling the shots, when in fact what we have in this country now are corporate bureaucrats calling the shots and making those kinds of decisions. And I don't think people realize that those people who are calling the shots now are motivated by Wall Street. These companies are very beholden to Wall Street investors and analysts and have to report their earnings every 3 months. And by law, they have to enhance shareholder value as their number one priority. And that makes a big difference in how someone who is approving claims takes a look at that claim, because everyone who works in a company knows that they have to do their part to make sure the company makes its profit expectations.
So give me a picture of what that is actually like. You know, as someone who has been a worker in the private insurance industry for a really long time, how do you experience the pressure of Wall Street, you know, on a daily basis? How does it actually play out in your life?
Well, it starts there are four times a year in which the companies have to announce their earnings. And you are always worried as to whether or not you've done your part as an individual employee to help the company meet the analyst and Wall Street's expectations. I've seen in one day a company's share price fall about 20% because the company did not meet the investor's expectations by just a fraction of a point. And I'll explain that at some point later, but we're talking about just small movements in what the industry refers to as a medical loss ratio. This goes back to the percentage of a premium dollar that is paid out in claims. Investors want less and less to be paid in claims because that makes more and more money available to them.
Let's take a moment and explain what a medical loss ratio is.
Right. A medical loss ratio is related to how much a company actually pays in claims of the premiums that it receives. For example, if you pay $1 in a premium, the insurance company these days more than likely will not spend more than 80 cents of that dollar paying claims. It's fallen a lot over the last few years to reach that point. And many of the big companies, it's in the 70s. So it's getting smaller, and there's pressure on these companies for that to come down every single quarter, which means that less and less money is going to pay claims. That puts a lot of pressure on the executives and the managers of these companies to really review the claims more carefully. And there's this almost implied pressure. There's not a memo that's written that says you shall deny so many claims this quarter, but there is the expectation that you have to do your part to help meet those expectations.
Now, this is all fairly benign language. Even denying claims doesn't sound like someone dying or missing a necessary medical procedure. What you're describing is a process by which the insurance industry's profits and performance and the jobs of all the people in that industry are more or less reliant on the extent to which they deny people health care.
It's very true. And one of the things that I've said is that they dump people who are sick, and that's how they make money. They make money by trying to exclude people who've had some history of illness. They call this pre-existing conditions. So they try to avoid paying claims of anyone who has had a history of any kind of illness. But also, after they are enrolled, they will often look at an application to see if someone might have inadvertently left off some information or even committed fraud. But most of us don't always remember everything we've been treated for in our history. So a lot of people who do go to the doctor, they might incur quite a large number of claims. That will trigger a review, and it's not just individuals. Employees of small companies are just as vulnerable to being dumped as individuals are.
So there You're saying there are people in insurance companies whose job it is just to go through and figure out ways to deny people?
There really are. There really are. And it's only come to light recently that some companies have actually paid bonuses to employees to scrutinize applications. And there actually have been paid bonuses by finding the most and determining how they can, how many of these, how these applications or these policies that they can rescind. The term is rescission when they do that. In California alone, I think the regulators ultimately found that about 20,000 policyholders had been, their policies had been rescinded, and that enabled the companies to avoid paying $300 million in claims.
Which is good for their stock price.
Excellent for the stock price. When you're talking about that much money, that makes a difference to Wall Street.
Can you give me a hypothetical example of how that process would work? Like the family has a problem, they go to the doctor calls the insurance company, the file gets refused. Like, can you actually sort of walk me through what that would be like for the human beings involved?
Yeah, I can, and it's a good point, because when you're in the executive suite at these insurance companies, you think in terms of numbers, and you don't really think that these numbers relate to people. That you're talking about dollars, or you're talking about maybe 8 million members that you've got enrolled in a health plan, or we talk about the 46 million people who are uninsured, 25 million who are underinsured. So we don't really think that those are real flesh and blood people. And the same is true when you have an individual or a family that's that really is needing care. An example occurred just about a month before I decided to leave my company. A 17-year-old girl in California was told by her doctor she needed to have a transplant, a liver transplant. This was at the UCLA Medical Center in Los Angeles. Her doctors felt that was vital. It was the only thing that could save her life. When Cigna's clinicians reviewed the request, they denied it. They denied coverage for it. And that meant that the family couldn't afford to pay for it. They didn't have the resources themselves to pay for the procedure. The girl ultimately died. Now, Cigna did a few hours, unfortunately, just a few hours before the young girl died, agree to pay for it, but this was after a lot of public pressure was brought to bear.
You were out front in that.
I was.
In that time.
I was.
Were you fighting within the company to say, what the hell, you guys? I mean, you're the PR guy, so your main concern in your job is how the company comes off.
Exactly.
This is terrible for the company, so you must have been saying, just pay for the goddamn transplant.
Well, what happens, in the job that I had, part of my role was to make sure that the management, the executive management, and others in the company took into consideration the public relations consequences of taking a certain course of action. This, unfortunately, had taken, this claim had been denied before it was brought to my attention, which, I guess is the appropriate thing to do. I couldn't nor shouldn't be involved in these decisions on a day-to-day basis. But in this particular case, it was very high stakes, and her doctors had recommended this. And it was only after the family had been able to generate a lot of media attention and the support of the California Nurses Association that the company took notice. Yeah, I said, look, guys, this is not publicity that's going to go away in just a few hours. This is going to last for a while. And it did. And the company, as I said, ultimately did change its mind, but it was too late.
At the same time, you're getting all these media requests. What does Cigna say? All this pressure is building. People are having press conferences. The family speaking out. Public sympathy is rising.
Yeah.
And you're, I guess, stonewalling a lot of those journalists or issuing press releases.
You do just take numbers and say, I'll get back to you, because you need to make sure that you've got to, you know what you're supposed to say. And you have to be very careful in a situation like that. Some because there are laws that restrict what you can say about an individual patient, and I think that's good. They're privacy laws. So you have to be careful in that regard, that you don't break any laws. But on the other hand, you have to make sure that what you say is consistent with what the corporate point of view is and what the lawyers say you should say. So you have to be very careful, and that goes on. And that's one reason why it sometimes seems like it's a long time. It is a long time before we can get back to a reporter with a statement, and usually it's I wouldn't say well-crafted, but it's certainly a well-edited statement.
And so what was the personal, emotional experience for you in that time What was the internal process for you?
It was the most difficult thing I think I've ever experienced in my career. Partly because it was a 17-year-old girl and I have a young daughter. I can just imagine what the family was going through. She had an older brother and my daughter does too. So it became, I guess I just identified with the family maybe more than in other situations. And it was playing out in real time on TV. It really captured the media's attention. And the family was able to stage a protest in front of my company's headquarters in California, the regional headquarters. And it was on live TV, and I was watching that and knowing that the statements I was issuing were being picked up by the media. But also during that time, it was during that time that the company decided to reverse the denial and agree to cover the procedure. And I was watching the protest on TV and knew that it was going to be difficult to get that message to the family. So I called one of the people who worked in the building there and said, "Look, you've got to get this message to the family." And it was communicated to the mother that the company had agreed to pay for it. And of course the family was just jubilant there. They felt that there was time for the transplant to take place and that Natalene's chances of survival had increased, but it was just too late, unfortunately.
So let's go back to talking about money and numbers again for a little bit. Okay. Health insurance premiums have skyrocketed, gone up on average 87% in the last 6 years. Why such a big jump in what people are paying for insurance?
Well, because a crazy system in the United States. There really are not enough controls on how healthcare is paid for. And insurance companies in the last decade said, "Let us be in charge. We can make sure that we can keep those costs down." And that was during the heyday of managed care, and they felt that managed care was the silver bullet at that time. They could apply pressure on doctors on prescribing medications and being more cost effective. But that was just very brief. It was just a very brief period of time in which it seemed to work. And the in this country, there is very little regulation compared to a lot of other healthcare systems. The compensation for healthcare providers is much, much higher in this country than it is elsewhere. The insurance companies have pretty much, I think, thrown in the towel of being able to control those expenses. So what they're doing now is shifting the more of the cost of healthcare onto the shoulders of working men and women in this country.
So the big debate in Washington right now, at this very moment, is will healthcare reform be affordable? Can they make it pay for itself? Can it be affordable in terms of the national finances? What do you think of that debate?
I think you're exactly right. That's the fundamental question. Congress come up with a way to change a system so that it does control cost? But when they do that, you're going to be getting opposition from some of the vested interests who profit a great deal from the way the system is run right now. The pharmaceutical industry, for example, has always resisted more regulation and rate controls, and they will continue to do that. None of these industries want to have more regulation. They might say they welcome more, but they really don't. They will fight it behind the scenes. So it's going to be a challenge. There really does need to be, though, very comprehensive reform that will keep costs down and will also affect and change the way providers are paid in this country. It's not just about the health insurers, but it is about every other part of the healthcare system that needs to be addressed.
At the same time, though, I was struck by the premise of this whole healthcare reform. I mean, I think there's a lot of points, a lot of people who are arguing that even the best case scenario with the strong public option and everything else is not necessarily going to solve the healthcare problems in this country. But aside from that, the president says, "I will not sign a bill that increases the deficit over the next 10 years. I don't recall anyone saying that about the Bush tax cuts,
right,
which cost $1.3 trillion in 10 years,
right,
right to the deficit.
Yeah.
I don't remember anyone saying that about the wars in Iraq or Afghanistan.
Right.
And I don't remember anyone saying that about the Wall Street bailouts either.
Exactly.
So why does healthcare have to be cost neutral?
It shouldn't be, and I think that was a mistake for the president to say that. Maybe he said it because he felt it was a politically correct thing to say. I think it's one of those things he might live to regret. I think that members of Congress and the President and the American people need to see what we do in health care reform to be an investment in our people, and certainly our young people. The way the system is going now, it's going to get worse, and it's affecting the United States' ability to be competitive globally. Mm. So I think it needs to be looked at not as necessarily a cost. Yeah, I think it's inevitable that the government will have to pay more to make sure that more of our people have access to care. But it should be viewed as an investment, not as an expense.
The industry is, healthcare industries are spending $1.4 million a day now in this crucial moment, with hundreds of lobbyists inside, writing parts of the legislation, bringing strong-arm tactics. We're stuck on the outside because we can't see that process. We can't get our cameras in those rooms. We can't even really get any of the people who are in those rooms to tell us what goes on in there and what it's like. Right. So as someone who has more of an insight into what's going on in the back rooms in D.C. right now, can you describe it? Can you paint me a picture of what $1.4 million a day actually means in human terms and the interactions and in people's daily lives?
Well, there are just scores of lobbyists who are all over Capitol Hill representing the special interests, in particular the insurance industry. The individual companies and the trade associations have spent lots and lots of money, millions and millions of dollars, just on lobbyists alone. And these lobbyists are often former members of Congress or staff members who still have very close connections to members. They have access, they have entree to the power in Washington. And they also have a lot of lawyers who know how to write legislation. So what you're not seeing is a lot of this going on behind the scenes of actually legislative language being proposed to members of Congress or to staff to try to get inserted in legislation or to try to make sure that something is not included. The public plan, for example, is something that the insurance industry is going flat out to try to kill. And you can bet that there is a lot of pressure being applied in many different ways to try to keep it out of legislation, and if it can't, to try to get it out when it goes into conference committee. And if that doesn't work, they will work behind the scenes to try to kill reform altogether.
So who's in there actually representing the interests of people who need health care in this country?
Unfortunately, there aren't many people. There are some organizations that that do have some lobbyists on the Hill, but they're so vastly outnumbered that I wonder, about what kind of legislation we ultimately will have. That's why it's so important, I think, for Americans who did vote for change this last time. They voted for more Democrats. They voted for a president to be who campaigned a lot on his healthcare platform. That means a lot to people, and I think they need to realize that just voting is not enough. They're going to have to apply pressure themselves on the people they voted for. And they need to do that by picking up the phone and calling, and it makes a difference. It really does. And to write letters and to send emails. You need to do that just in sheer numbers to have any chance of outweighing or come close to even balancing the influence of the lobbyist.
The debate is really focused on having a public option.
Right.
And we'll have lots of people on either side debating this back and forth. But in places where they've had a public option competing with private insurance plans, in states, Tennessee, where we just have been, as you know, there was a big expansion of 10 care.
Right.
But in fact, the public option has been undermined.
Yes, it has.
And it just cost more money than they planned because the need is so great.
Right.
And they didn't get the kind of powers that they needed to get drug prices down, to get hospital and doctors' costs down, procedure costs down. So a lot of people are arguing from the single-payer camp that this public option actually is a half measure that will ultimately fail. I think people also feel that some change is better than no change.
Yeah.
But how do you see, as someone who's watched from the inside, how do you see this the way that this public option could play out if they manage to pass it?
I think it could make a difference. I think it's hard for a single state to make the changes that are necessary. It's just not, they're just not big enough. They don't have the scale. They're not able to scale up enough to make the changes that are necessary or to control the special industries as it could be, special interests as it could be at the national level. Mm-hmm. I think it could make a big difference because a public plan would have, I think by law, a standard benefit package that would be comprehensive enough to cover most things, to keep people from going bankrupt if they have a major illness, which happens a lot in this country. I think it would be a plan that wouldn't have to have the high administrative cost that the private plans have. And that in, that would put a lot of pressure on the private plans to operate more efficiently. Investors wouldn't necessarily like it. They don't think that a public plan will pass. That's why you've seen that they're sticking with largely their investments in these companies. They think that the insurers are going to win the day, that they will be able to keep the public plan from either being included or it'll be so weak that it will be ineffective. But I think it can help. I think we need to try it. I understand what the single-payer advocates are saying. The single-payer systems work very well in other countries. Right now, as a pragmatist, this year is probably not going to happen. It just doesn't have quite the support. But there are so many people who need some relief that I think we need to try the public plan approach.
On the other hand, if it passes and doesn't work, if the most optimistic supporters of both options are right and the public option somehow leads to a single-payer plan, do you think that this country needs to get rid of its for-profit health insurance industry, the industry that you've worked in and lived on and bought your house with and brought up your family with for all of these years?
I'm glad you mentioned that because I might say that Cigna was very good to me. I have a lot of friends there and I made money there. I absolutely did. And a lot of people who work for those companies sure don't want their jobs to go away. And I fully understand that. I think that states should have the ability to try single payer. And I understand in Canada that indeed happened many years ago, that it began at the provincial level. And I think it could happen in this country at the state level. Big states like California have actually passed legislation that would create a single-payer system, but it's been vetoed. Here in Pennsylvania, there is strong support for a single-payer approach to health care. I think it could work. Interestingly, one of the biggest advocates for the private health insurance industry and who is considered the kind of the guru of the consumer-driven movement talks a lot about Switzerland as being a model. And conceivably, it could work. But in Switzerland, there are no for-profit health insurance companies. There is private insurance, but they're not for-profit. And I think that makes a big difference. When these companies are not beholden to Wall Street, when they are not the ones who really rule the day, I think it makes a big difference.
I mean, there's a very fundamental issue here that kept coming up and up again in our time in Tennessee talking to people around RAM, which is, the question is, does the profit motive have any place in the provision of healthcare?
You know, I've come to think no. I was really a believer in the for-profit system for many years, but I saw it playing out, and the farther up the corporate ladder I got, and the more I saw how companies make money and the things they have to do to always satisfy those investors, it also forces the companies to look very short-term. When you have to announce your earnings, your financial results every 3 months, you're focused on that. So there's very little long-term focus on our healthcare system by these companies. There can't be. I do not think that for-profit companies have benefited this country. In fact, you know, if they had been able to do their job, we wouldn't be having this debate today. I wouldn't be here talking to you.
What do you think of Obama's strategy so far to get the big powerful groups at the table, to have these backroom negotiated industry deals where this sector will promise $180 billion in savings and this sector will promise $85 billion in savings, and the details aren't really clear, they're not written down, but they're not running ads against reform. What do you think of that whole strategy? Can these corporate interests be co-opted the way the president wants them to be, or are they playing a game that they know they can win?
I think they're playing a game they know they can win, or I think they're playing a game they think they can win. I don't think the president's naive. I think he's maybe abiding by the adage of keep your friends close and your enemies closer. I'm hoping that's the case. I think he's he's realistic. I think he really knows that they're not really his friends, that they will, behind the scenes, knife his or rip his reform proposal to shreds if it inhibits their ability to make profits. He knows that. But I think that it was to his and the industry's advantages from a public relations point of view to do that, I think. But I frankly think that the industry may have gained more in a public relations sense than the president did, because they are being perceived, I think, by some Americans, maybe a lot of Americans, as really offering some solutions this year. They keep saying they're coming to the table with solutions. They're not saying anything different this time than they did 15 years ago.
Are they coming to the table with solutions?
They're not coming to the table with any solutions that I want anything to do with. No.
We need to talk a little bit about RAM. We had a very intense 2 days in Tennessee. I've covered similar projects before and seen those healthcare sites of delivery. I know you have a personal connection to Tennessee.
Yeah.
And having spent a couple of days there and being so moved, both disturbed and inspired by what we saw. Tell me how RAM affected you.
I did grow up in Tennessee, just a few miles from where you were. And you grew up around poverty. That's a part of the United States that has always been poor, or there's a lot of poverty in that part of the country. I was visiting my relatives a couple of years ago, and I just picked up the local paper and I saw that this organization, which is Remote Area Medical, was having what I thought was some kind of a health fair in a nearby town just across the state line in Virginia. So I decided I'd check it out, because one of the reasons that there was a story was because John Edwards, who at that time was campaigning for president, had come by and had made a stop there. So I was intrigued, and I drove up there, and I was just absolutely stunned. I wasn't prepared for what I saw. It was being held at a county fairgrounds where, they have prized pigs and cattle and chickens when the county fair comes to town. But doctors who were volunteering their time, and nurses and dentists, had come to scrub down the animal stalls so that they could treat people who didn't have any means to pay for care otherwise. People that waited once a year to come and get care and stand in long lines, and it was raining that day, and they were standing or sitting in long, long lines. And many people had camped out or slept in their cars waiting for the gates to open at 5:30. And it was just an absolutely overwhelming experience. You know, I knew to a certain extent that this existed, but in my corporate office, again, I dealt mainly with numbers, and I really hadn't really thought about individual human beings and how they're affected by our dysfunctional system until I saw that at Wise, Virginia. And I realized that these people could have been people I grew up with or neighbors of my parents. And it just hit me like I was being hit with a two before across the face, because it was that much of a shock. And I thought, what country am I in? You know, Americans think they've got the best healthcare system in the country, in the world. They think that because Americans like to think that they're the best at everything. And we do have some of the best facilities. The tragedy is that so few of us, or a growing number of us, have the means to use those facilities. We don't have access to them. We don't have insurance coverage. And the median household income in this country is $50,000. Globally, that sounds like a lot of money. But when you consider the high cost of health care in this country, and the fact that a family premium, annual premium, is now about $13,000 to $14,000. Most people can't afford that, and that's just to pay for the insurance. That doesn't include the out-of-pocket expenses that they're having to pay more and more of when they do get sick. And that's, you know, to get back to your question, it was just an overpowering experience, and I realized then that I was not doing what I was supposed to be doing. I felt then that I needed to do something, and that my life would change pretty radically at some point, and it has.
What has it been like for you to live inside this remarkable story of the whistleblower, of someone who has a moment? It doesn't happen all in 1 second, but you had a moment or two that changed your life and your life path forever. And now you're sought after by major media. You're having a powerful, transformative voice in this key moment in the debate. And your life is you're totally different now, right? What's it been like for you to make this transition?
Well, it's been very different. I knew that the moment I gave that testimony before the Senate, that marked the beginning of a big change for me. I knew that going into that, and it made me a little bit nervous, as you can imagine. But I didn't quite expect what has happened since then. It's been gratifying. I've had enormous support from people. I've gotten people who I went to school with and grew up with that I hadn't thought about in many years have contacted me. That's been very gratifying because I know I've touched a nerve to a certain extent, and I certainly have my critics. On the other hand, it's just me here, and I still pet the dog and take the trash out, and in many ways it seems like I'm looking at somebody else doing this rather than me being the person sitting here talking to you. It's been a remarkable change. I'm grateful to have this opportunity, though. I don't want to diminish it. I am really glad that I have the ability to speak out and to try to make sure people in this country understand how the special interests manipulate public opinion, how they mislead, and the reasons why they do, and that the things they say are to protect their interests, not to increase people's access to health care in this country.
There's always a hope when someone steps out from a senior role in industry and starts telling the truth about what goes on behind the scenes, that they'll inspire other people to do the same. Yeah. What would you say to your former colleagues in the industry, not necessarily in your company, but the people who played the senior role that you played at Cigna in all those other companies? If you could talk to them off the record, what would you say to them about what they ought to do?
I would ask them to listen to the conscience and step back and not think so much about themselves, which is what I certainly did. I can only speak for myself and the things that I went through. And I was able to, and I did stay in my job in the insurance industry for 20 years because it gave me a great lifestyle. And it's really, really hard to walk away from that. I would just tell them, though, money is not everything. That you would be just amazed at what a wonderful feeling it is to think that you're doing something that really is right, that you feel proud of, and you think your family will be proud of you for doing. And I have no regrets whatsoever. I'm not making the kind of money I made before by any means, but it's the most gratifying thing I have ever done. And I would encourage them to consider doing the same thing. They'll feel better. They'll sleep better at night.
One of the things, this will be my last question, we may get a couple of cutaways, but one of the things that that really struck me looking at the faces of people in at RAM, here is this circle of faces in the fluorescent light coming from the high school entrance. It's dark still. And the amount of need written on those faces. And one of the things that those people need, apart from the pain in their mouth and their body and everything else and the need for treatment, was the need to be treated with dignity.
Absolutely.
And the sense that this system dehumanizes people. Yeah. You've seen this from a few different angles now. What's your take on that essential human dynamic of how people feel? Because health goes right to the heart of who you are as a human being.
I know what you're talking about because I felt that when I went to RAND the first time to that expedition in Virginia. I want to invite the president, I want to invite members of Congress to come to these RAM expeditions to see that. Members of Congress are, in a sense, insulated from what really is happening in this country as much as insurance company executives. They hear from constituents, but they need to see this like that for them to really understand the desperation that so many people in this country feel because they don't have access to health care. It's an American tragedy, and I really hope that our lawmakers can really start seeing this from their perspective and act from their constituents' perspective and not from the special interests, which they're able to make those campaign contributions, but they need to know who votes for them.